Well, hello, this is a data-driven Formula One with Patrick Hansson, Kana Pogrebna.
Hello, Kana. Hello, all.
Hi, Patrick. So today we're talking about 1974. Very interesting season. Lots of, there was, I think, quite a big intrigue about who is going to win.
Exactly. And we will, of course, discuss this. Also, unfortunately, again, a season with tragical and fatal accidents. As we have to say, it was quite common in the first half of the 1970s.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
And let's see the season in a nutshell.
So as usual, if we look at the table, I mean, this is the type of table that you want to see because lots of different names. So basically you can see that quite a few teams are doing well and, a complete variety. And perhaps from this table, you could probably figure out who won the Constructors Championship, but Driver Championship is quite, I think, even if you look at it, is a little bit difficult to figure out.
I think not only difficult, but impossible, as you would have to consider also the positions 1 to 6 and not only the winners in this case.
As we will see, the lead actually has more wins than the rest, but yeah, it's still, as you can see, a lot of interesting things happened, and we can see many people having 2 wins and one person has 3 wins. but in any case, it is it is a very exciting season, so this is the type of season that we want to see. If you notice also the pole positions, this is where the intrigue comes from. Even though, if you look at winning driver, you can see that Emerson Fittipaldi has 3 wins, while the rest so others have maybe 2. If we look at pole position, we have a complete domination of one person, and that's Niki Lauda. So today we will talk about all these guys quite a lot. Yeah, and a really exciting season.
Exactly, and let's say if you know how the Formula One season continues the next years, you may say having Niki Lauda and Ferrari as king of the pole positions, maybe this had been an indicator that the Ferrari team, after very problematic years before, finally managed to turn around and gets stronger and stronger. 1974 with Niki Lauda, maybe it was only the pole position, as they could not translate it also in winning drivers, or as Niki Lauda only won once that season, but maybe it was an early indicator where Ferrari was going in the next years. So maybe
he won 2 times, twice. Spanish and Dutch Grand Prix. It's a little bit confusing because there is fastest lap.
I saw it. So I just wanted to finish a good omen now for 2021, where we had twice pole position by Charles Leclerc, but in the race it's still not possible for Ferrari to bring such results, but maybe also a sign, an early indicator for turnaround.
Yeah, I think that this is we obviously haven't talked about Niki Lauda in a separate episode, but I think Niki Lauda brought a completely new wave into Ferrari with his ability to actually analyze things. Because, I mean, if you are talking about Mr. Analytics, this is Niki Lauda. So he is the guy who understood very well the calculation of risk, right? So it's all about kind of understanding how risky it's going to be and taking really informed decisions about risk taking. So so this is really kind of, he brought a completely new way of thinking about racing to Ferrari, and this is really cool, and this is what we see actually in 1974 as a kind of really pronounced factor, even though Niki Lauda of course appeared in previous season, but you know, we in 1974 this approach really started to pay off.
Exactly, yeah. And this is quite interesting, as Niki Lauda practically came as the number two driver to Ferrari, as based on a recommendation by Clay Regazzoni. And also what we will shortly mention later today is this turnaround at Ferrari, of course, is not only triggered by one person. Also a key figure here is I think Luca Montezemolo, who also joined Ferrari in 1974.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. But also, yeah, I just want to say that we finally are stepping into the territory when we can really talk about serious analytics and risk analytics. And yeah, the driving forces of this were, you know, actually, well, of course, the teams, but also drivers. And one of the most, one of the key figures, I would say, in bringing in the calculation of risk in racing is, of course, Niki Lauda. So he was, of course, doing it from kind of driver perspective. But very soon we will see that, you know, game theorists and, you know, helping the analytics teams. And, you know, currently we definitely have decision theorists working on the ground in many teams and providing advice based on data. So, yeah, so this is really a result of hard work of many people. But, yeah, we have to acknowledge Niki Lauda as, you know, one of the pioneers in this.
Of course, he was one of the key figures who brought this change to Ferrari and also changed Formula One over the years. So let's start.
With rule change.
Exactly, let's discuss with the rule change, and it's not something completely new, as we already saw this coming from 1973, is that the teams not always change the numbers in the races, but now the first time we had really fixed numbers for this, since the beginning of 1974, based on the results from the earlier season, meaning that Ronnie Peterson started with the number one. This based Jackie Stewart retired, who was the champion of the 73 season. So practically, the new rule started already with the exception.
Mm-hmm. Right. So yeah, and we will see also the, as you can see, the escalation in rule changes, and we will see a lot of improvements of safety regulations in later years. But essentially, yeah, if you recall our previous episodes, then so in 1950s we didn't have too many changes, so, and even in 1960s, but from late 1960s to current time, I say, yeah, we see quite a lot of regulations being introduced, and yeah, definitely that's also kind of this escalation of regulating is another feature that really is quite distinct in Formula One, right? So it's probably, there is probably no other sport that has more changes every season than Formula One.
Exactly, if you would compare, for example, with football or soccer, where we have rule changes, I don't know, every 10 years or so, in opposite to this Formula One, practically every year something is different. Even they change regulations if needed inside the same season. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, so, and again, we're starting in Argentina, which is which was, I have to say, quite a standard start of the season for many, many yeah. years until yes. very, very recently. Yeah, and yeah, it's and exactly. here we had Danny Hume, who surprised everyone, I guess, and, you know, won the race. So, yeah. Fantastic, yes. Fantastic race. Actually, you know, there are tapes that you can see of the race, and yeah, highly recommend it. It's very, very exciting race to watch.
Right, and as always, we start on the south side of the Earth, based to climate. And of course, Argentina and Brazil both included, as we see here, a rising number of fans due to the Argentinian and Brazilian drivers. On the one hand, Emerson Fittipaldi, but also Carlos Reutemann as an Argentinian driver.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course, we also have to mention the fatal accident was Peter Revson in South Africa. So that was the start of what Patrick referred to as a tragic season yes. in 1974. And actually it highlighted how, you know, how a lot of problems that we observed in Formula One so far were not really solved in terms of safety, you know, so yeah. it still wasn't safe. And yeah, so the so unfortunately this was the first of this fatal accidents that year.
Yes, and if we see the fatal accidents of that time, there are certain patterns. I can say that mostly they are not triggered by human behavior, so it's not by caused by reckless driving, but in really most of the cases, there's a technical problem with the car, which also here.
Yeah.
As the Revson suffered a front suspension failure. And so this was the reason for the accident. And the other, I think the other pattern is where we see with the fatal accidents in the past and also unfortunately next year is that the AMCO barriers are still not safely installed, so maybe causing more harm than preventing harm.
Yeah, we discussed this in great depth when we discussed the Lotus team, and you know, like we said before, there were obviously just two ways in making cars faster back in the day. The first way was to innovate on the engine side. And the second thing was to innovate on the lightness of the car, right? And because, you know, a lot of teams took that path, you know, it was obviously at the cost of making it less stable. And indeed, there were quite a lot of mechanical failures as well as technical failures. But also we also have to understand that when you have a mechanical failure, very often it is also combined with human error, because when you have an unexpected situation like this, it's often a combination of factors, and one of those factors is often human error as well.
Yeah, I would say practically always at the end, some mechanic did not something completely correct, or the driver overdrove the car. So, I mean, at the end, you cannot hold responsible a machine, but only a human. So at the end, somehow you can always relate it to a human.
Yeah, absolutely. And also we have to understand that this is a race at very high speeds. So it's not only the team in question that is you know suffering from this mechanical and human errors, but also the people who are around the car yes. that has been affected, and it's very difficult to sometimes do something if you, especially if you are in very close pursuit during race, then you know if you it's just sometimes you cannot help it.
Exactly, and as you mentioned, the cars of course not had been on the same safety levels, but also the racetracks often had been quite unsafe, as we may say here also. This had been the case for Kyalami, but also the other races still had a lot of problems with these AMCO barriers, which not have been correctly installed. So we have, let's say, unsafe cars, but also unsafe racetracks.
Yeah, and to kind of finish up maybe the topic with the South African incident. Of course, you all probably remember Peter Revson. We talked about him before, really great driver. We didn't have a separate episode, but we did talk about him in other episodes. This also had a significant impact on the competition in the season, because the shadow team basically left the season. So they just said that they are not going to continue the season due to this fatality. And in a sense, the competition lost a constructor as a result, yep. not only a driver.
Exactly. So with this, we are coming finally to the European continent, going to Spain. And here we have then the first victory for Niki Lauda, before mm-hmm. Ronnie Peterson and Clay Regazzoni.
Yeah, actually, this is the race where Niki Lauda, like Patrick said, where he actually realized his pole position. So he was on pole. He also had the fastest lap,
right.
and he won the race. So it kind of this triple achievement for Niki Lauda. So yeah, really also a really interesting race if you get the chance to watch it.
Exactly. Besides this, we see two new teams, the Trojan team and the team from Chris Emmon, also a very famous driver from New Zealand. I assume due to travel costs, they decided not to go overseas, but only to start in Europe. And also we saw now the first driver from Liechtenstein called Ricky von Opel, but he's not familiar with the Opel company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when we went to Belgium, then we had Emerson Fittipaldi winning the race, and with Niki Lauda in second place, and Jody Schleicher in third place. Again, you know, great achievement for Emerson Fittipaldi. We had a separate episode about him. And if you watch that, you know that this is one of my favorite drivers of all time. So, yeah. And you need to check it out, to check out that episode. But yeah, very significant episode, very significant season, this 1974 season in the career of Emerson Fittipaldi. And definitely this Belgium race helped him right. a lot
Pretty
that
much.
Season. Yeah, that's right.
And not to forget Jody Scheckter, young talent from South Africa, who also should play a major role in Formula One the later years.
Yeah, we did talk about him a little bit earlier, but yeah.
Quite ruthless in the beginning, as due to the accidents, some of his colleagues already wanted to expel him from Formula One racing, but luckily McLaren could prevent it, and so he was with us also in 1974.
Yeah, and another thing I think that we need to mention here is that if previously we had this rivalry between pretty much Lotus and Ferrari, You know, here we finally can talk about really McLaren emerging as a really competitive team, and you know, we have, you know, McLaren and Ferrari in a sense, which kind of to some extent continues up to now, but you know, it's after the death of Bruce McLaren, there was a big question of whether the team will survive at all or not. So, and we can say that from 1970, when Bruce McLaren tragically died, to 1974, they really managed to pull the act together, the McLaren team did, I mean, and actually create a really competitive team where they could also attract really talented drivers and very good engineers.
Exactly, and in fact, we have the same rivalry today, 2021, where McLaren and Ferrari are directly competing about this third position in the season. Mm-hmm. And let's say, I think if there are two teams which are the most important teams of Formula One, I think most people would mention Ferrari and McLaren as the, so these are, I think, the most well-known teams.
Yeah, it's just
my personal opinion.
Well, it's not. It's just also statistical fact. If we look at the history, right? Ferrari participated in every single season, and if we take McLaren, they are competing consistently from 1970s. These are two longest surviving teams in the sport. So it's just it's a fact.
Exactly, and I would assume if we do a survey with people on the streets to name some Formula One teams, I assume these two would be on the first two positions.
Yeah, and when Patrick and I forgot which episode that was exactly, but when we kind of analyzed the success of the teams, I think it was kind of Ferrari first and McLaren second, pretty much. I think that's correct. So, yeah, definitely. So this was probably the beginning of it in 1974. Because previous seasons, yes, the team existed, but, you know, it was not clear whether it was really competitive or not.
Exactly. And let's come to Monte Carlo. And we have been speaking about McLaren, Ferrari, and here we have a Lotus victory by Ronnie Peterson before John Scheckter and Jean-Pierre Jarry.
Mm-hmm. And we also at this point can talk about much exaggerated rivalry. Exaggerated in movies and fiction literature between Niki Lauda and James Hunt. So James Hunt is present in the Swedish Scandinavian Grand Prix with Jody Scheckter being first, and you can see James Hunt is there on podium, and of course this is the year when Graham Hill earned his last points, the last points were actually in this particular Swedish Grand Prix.
Yes, and statistically this was the first victory for South African driver in the Formula One championship.
We are still due to talk about women and, you know, how it is like gender-wise. Of course, Formula One was not very diverse sport, but in terms of nationalities, I think, there was a huge improvement between in 1950s and 1960s, it was pretty much Italy versus UK. Yeah. Now we have a lot more diversity. We have drivers from New Zealand, Australia, South Africa, and even, you know, competitive people. Of course, France and Germany. But we really have some diversity in the backgrounds of these folks.
Exactly. And here we see also that Shadow returned with Bertil Ross, but the team wasn't consolidated yet. after the good the great loss, so it was also the only race for Bertil was with the shadow.
Yeah, I don't think they returned into the season. I think they just decided to race just for the sake of trying new things out for the next season. So it wasn't really like proper participation. But
Exactly. And I don't know how have been the contracts in the 1970s, but I assume it's they're also a binding that you have to start all the races or at least a number of races and cannot to leave the season if you want to. I'm not quite sure how it was in the 1970s.
No, I think you had to basically, yeah, I mean, you could probably miss some of the non-European things if you couldn't.
Exactly.
Participate, but when you would talk about European races, of course you had to show up. But I think they, the shadow team, made it very clear that they're not competing. I think they just were allowed to race on this occasion just to be able to do some tests, essentially.
Then we are in the Netherlands, as always, quite near the North Sea in Zandvoort, and here second victory for Niki Lauda, then Clay Regazzoni and Emerson Fittipaldi.
Yeah, and if you look at this list, this is pretty much the list of main competitors that season, right? What? So these three pretty much were the ones. You can see, if you're watching us on YouTube, you can see Clay Regazzoni, his photo on this page. Yeah, it was the second win for Niki Lauda.
Yes, and slowly also a change of generation. We saw already last points for Graham Hill, and here we have the last points for Mike Hellwood, which he got for the fourth position.
Yeah, and here Niki Lauda, if you're watching us on YouTube, and so the French Grand Prix, we had Ronnie Peterson, Niki Lauda, and Clay Regazzoni. Again, like I said before, Ronnie Peterson, very, I think, underappreciated driver, and but a great driver nevertheless. So you probably heard a lot about Niki Lauda and Clay Regazzoni, but not a lot about Ronnie Peterson.
Yeah, and I'm quite sure we will change this also with a special episode one day about Ronnie Peterson, as it's really quite interesting person. Unfortunately, also quite tragical. Yeah. But I'm sure we will also speak about him separately.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. UK.
Okay.
Yeah, so, and if you watched us on YouTube previously, you saw kind of a picture, a few slides before this photo. You saw a slide where there was a picture of Emerson Fittipaldi. It's actually his photo from the Silverstone race. I think that was it was a really unlucky start for Niki Lauda, when he basically was not, he essentially didn't complete the race in the usual way. So he was just he just did 74 laps, and then he was allowed an extra lap because he essentially was blocked. That really affected his standing in the season. So I think this is another problem that we haven't discussed before, the processes, right? The pit processes in Formula One, and how a lot of mistakes were made by various teams, and how it these mistakes actually are costing drivers sometimes championships.
Yeah, but mistakes are part of being human. So, and Formula One is practically motorsports always on the limit, so it's quite predictable that there are errors from most people involved at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Also, of course, we have to mention that for more than a decade, we have again a female driver participating in the race in the form of Lella Lombardi. We discussed at the beginning the numbers as she joined in the middle of the season. She managed to get the 208 as the starting number. This related also to her sponsor, which was Radio Luxembourg, which has a wavelength of 208 meters. So she managed to get this number. And of course, this also related to the sponsor. We will speak with her also a little bit more separately, as not in 74, but the next year she will become the first woman scoring points in Formula One.
That's right, and I think the episode about women in Formula One is much overdue. And when we talk about women in Formula One, we of course will not only talk about female drivers, but also about managers and some really absolutely amazing engineers. So despite the fact that we don't have enough women racing, the yes. impact of women on the sport is actually quite significant, probably more significant yes. than most people realize.
Yes, and I think the development is quite positive that we have more women inside the sports, even if unfortunately not as drivers. And we may discuss why is this the case, because later in 1970s, we even had one race which two female drivers. So I think we had been already had more progress in the 1970s, at least if you only have to focus on the drivers. I mean, we see new developments as a pure series only for female drivers now in 2021. So I think it will be an interesting topic to discuss in a special episode.
Yes, definitely. Definitely. Well, there are a lot of reasons for this. We're not going to dive deep into this topic. Otherwise, it will take us probably an hour or more to discuss
exactly.
The reasons.
And for sure, we will have a special episode about this anyway.
Yeah.
So we're coming to Germany in the Nürburgring, and we discussed it various times before. The Nürburgring, also known as the Green Hell, one of the most dangerous tracks in 1974. Luckily, it not led to fatal accidents, but we have two examples where accidents led to the end of career. This also, of course, some related that in the case of Mike Hailwood, he wasn't he was also anyway relatively at the end of his longer career. So, but this was now the event who really triggered that he left Formula One, as he broke a leg in an accident. So that was his last race in Formula One. And similar also happened to Houghton Ganley, who suffered a serious accident at the Friday's free training, where again, the real suspension, so again, technical failure of the car led to the accident. And again, he went into the Armco barrier, ripping off the nose of his car, and both of his legs were dangling out of the car. And he got out on his own, but after being out, he collapsed and has been carried away. So this accident also meant his retirement from Formula One.
Yeah, I just want to also talk about a little, just for a couple of minutes about Mike Hailwood. So you see, if you're watching us on YouTube, you see his photo on the screens at the moment. And yeah, so Mike Hailwood, again, so he was one of the representatives of this, like Patrick said, older generation of drivers who mostly started in other sports. So Mike Hailwood had a nickname of Mike the Bike because he had an amazing ability to ride motorcycles, and he started in motorcycle racing and then moved into Formula One, which is quite a traditional path for 1960 drivers, but not so traditional for 1970 drivers, where we've already discussed this with Patrick before, that those folks were already starting at an early age, so pretty much like now, so they had they were already some schools more or less, and then they would go into for lower ranked formulas. So I mean, this was completely different for Mike Hailwood. Unfortunately, for all of us, I guess he got into an accident during Nürburgring race, and he had to stop his career. But this is, again, if you notice, again, we have these accidents in Nürburgring. We cannot stress enough with Patrick that it's a very difficult circuit, especially in unfavorable weather conditions, which actually we had in 1974 season.
In fact, practically every year, the weather from the Nürburgring is very changing. And even at, especially at the old Nürburgring, you could have a mixture between summer and on one hand and snow on the other side of the racetrack, as we really are in the middle of the mountains.
Yeah, absolutely. So that is true for Nürburgring, but and it also mostly true for Spa, right? A Belgium race, you can pretty much 100% guarantee that you can expect rain. And I think, again, on the analytics side, the teams are competing in predicting when exactly the rain is going to start and stop, and that creates a part of the excitement about the race. Unfortunately, back in 1970s, weather forecasts were not as precise, and obviously the teams were less ready for these things. And as a result, we have these injuries and quite life-changing consequences from them.
Yep.
But at least no one died. This is otherwise it would have been really a lot more serious. But of course, retirement is also not a great news, especially as a result of an injury.
Yeah, completely agreed.
Yeah, Ronnie Peterson on the screens. So here we have Austria and Italy, and Ronnie Peterson won in Monza that year, and Carlos Reutemann in Austria.
Yep, and again, Monza brought pretty much the same result as before, with Patterson and Fittipaldi finishing the first and the second position. Also last points for Arturo Merzario, who continued more in the sports cars series after he wasn't that lucky in Formula One. So more I think endurance pilot than somebody for the sprint races as in Formula One.
Yeah, Canada. So here we have for the first race for Penske team, which is quite a significant event. Fittipaldi, Regazzoni, and Rune Peterson in the first three places. So,
yep. Also, it was the first race for a young Austrian driver called Helmut König. Unfortunately, very tragic career for him, and he tried to start it at home in Austria, not qualified. Now he qualified in Canada, and unfortunately we will have to discuss him later because he will be the second fatal accident this year.
Yeah, that's right.
Last pole position for Emerson Fittipaldi, a very successful driver, so a little bit surprising seeing that he has already in 1974 his last pole position. And again, please check out our special episode about him, because he was a person of making bold decisions, and some for his benefit and some had not been working out that good, because well, we can already spoil this. He will leave McLaren at the end to join his brother for an all Brazilian team.
Yeah, absolutely. Probably one of the biggest mistakes in his career, but I bet he doesn't regret it. So yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if he regretted it, but he mentioned that it wasn't the most beautiful years of his life, his career.
Yeah, but I think, you know, choosing your family is not always the worst thing that you can do. So, yeah, I mean, he tried. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, yeah. And with this, Watkins Glen, California, victory for Carlos Reutemann. Mm-hmm. Then second place for the next Carlos Paste from Brazil, and we see on the third position James Hunt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So and this was already the 100th victory for the Ford Cosworth engine, so really an engine which was leading Formula One.
Yeah, dominating and at the start.
Dominated, yeah, that was the name. I'm looking for dominating Formula One for years now. And we will see later that practically all, besides two race teams, are using this Ford Cosworth engine. As you have mentioned, Ronnie Peterson and his qualities and skills as a driver. This also makes it clear, because we see here Tim Jenken, the second one, I think, on Lotus. He was disqualified because he started, despite the fact that he not even qualified for the race. So the second Lotus driver wasn't near to Ronnie Peterson's results over the whole season.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So here we also had this this incident with Helmut Koenig. When he basically had a suspension failure. So this is kind of coming back to Patrick's point that a lot of failures, at least in 1970s, were technical failures.
Yes, and let's say at an area where we had quite a number of accidents before, already Regazzoni, Beltoir and Andretti crashed here in the Praxis. And again, we see here what we discussed. The AMCO was insecurely installed and the bottom portion of it buckled as the vehicle struck in. And so again, it was the combination of the unsafe car with the unsafe AMCO at the track, which unluckily led to the fatal accident.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. This was the last race. For data scientists, a nightmare, I think, this season. We see it only who got the numbers, because in one race you got victory and the next one you're not even qualified in the first six positions. Also this based on the fact as the cars not had been very reliable in 1974. So, I mean, if you see just these numbers, very difficult to predict.
Yeah, I think we just probably need to also quickly explain that on the y-axis you have points, and on the x-axis you have race, each race, basically, at 15 races. And as you can see, it is quite a big problem. But Emerson Fittipaldi just edging on Clay Regazzoni with 3 points lead.
And let's say if we show it that way, it's a little bit easier So we see Emerson Fittipaldi was leading from the fifth to the eighth race, then lost against Niki Lauda, who was also leading. Then it was Clay Regazzoni practically leading until the 14th race, and only in the 15th race, Emerson Fittipaldi could ensure the championship, the title for himself.
Well, that's right.
So another and the second and last championship for Emerson Fittipaldi.
Yep. And this is obviously less surprising. Like you could probably figure out that McLaren did pretty well that season. Yeah, so McLaren in the lead. And so this is where we also started to see the decline of Lotus. As you can see, Lotus is already in the fourth place here. Mm-hmm. And we have Ferrari second and Tyrrell third that season. Brabham is still doing quite well. Like we explained before, Shadow had to exit mid-season, and you can see from the stable what we were emphasizing for the last few seasons that Ford is doing really well. So I think only Ferrari, I don't know, BRM, which engine BRM they had, probably also Ford.
No, I think BRM, they traditionally have their own engine.
But it's also kind of a fusion car, BRM, mm-hmm. right? It's very much kind of everything that is out there is put together. And so we basically have, you can see only one alternative really to Ford, which is Ferrari engine. At the time. And another I think interesting thing to mention is you can see the name of the sponsor appearing in the name of the constructor with either Marlboro Ford teams. Obviously Marlboro is not a producer of of anything for cars, but we will see a lot of it later on. But I mean, this is
I mean, also officially the name of the McLaren team that year was Texaco Marlboro McLaren, but everybody know it only as McLaren. I used the classic names instead of always including the sponsors.
I just want to mention that previously we only had sponsors appearing in liveries, but basically from the early 1970s, we actually also have the sponsors' names in team names for marketing purposes.
Yeah, exactly. So here we see
McLaren.
This is the typical Marlboro sponsorship until we know it practically until the early 2000s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So very iconic car. I mean, this is probably the car that you could see a lot. When you Google McLaren, you practically immediately find it.
Yeah, and let's say for me also quite retro design, as Texaco was quite well known, I think, in Europe and in Germany. So we had Texaco gas stations. I don't know when they left, maybe in the early 1990s. So a brand which we do not have in Europe anymore for a long, long time. Of course, they are still big here in the US.
Mm-hmm. Lotus, well, as usual, 1970s design. I mean, a black and amber colors, very nice car. I mean, I'm of course worried about the person who is riding it, irrespective who that person is, because it is probably one of the lightest cars in the sport. But it is very pretty. Yeah,
exactly. And as always, quite a pioneer in aerodynamics, as we see the back wing, a double back wing. So yeah. the again
well, that's that's Colin Chapman's desire to try things. Yeah.
Exactly. So again, always experimental, the Lotus. And with this, I think we come to a quite classic design, the Tyrrell 007.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in fact, if you look at Tyrrell, McLaren, several other competitors, they're very similar. But obviously, yeah, if when you look at Lotus or Ferrari, you always see something unusual.
That's right. And
but yeah, again, like I said, they look, they all look, well, I'm not going to say the same, but similar.
Yeah, but I say this triangle design, I think this is something which is quite typical for Brabham and which they will keep until the end of the 1970s.
Yeah, so that's another innovation and innovative thinking from so quite typical for Brabham is, of course, aerodynamics, the concentration on aerodynamics. And that concentration originally gave them quite a few season wins, and you know, so
yeah.
They kind of continue with this trend, basically in engineering innovation.
Yes. And with this, we are coming to Ferrari. As mentioned, the company has managed the turnaround. They had been able to compete. To win
and,
the championship.
And look how different it looks, right? It also looks different. So we said that Lotus kind of looks a little bit different, but this car looks different from the rest. You can tell it's different.
Exactly. And as you always speak about reading books, I have here also a very special book. And if we open it, we get this little car. Ooh. The number 11 from Clay Regazzoni. So we see, honestly, a very beautiful car and right, looking different than the other ones. And this was, let's say, the design which also should be continued the next years at Ferrari and which helped them to be quite successful in the second half of the 1970s. I know he's not a car designer, but I think this was the best place to include it into the presentation this year. Luca de Montezemolo joined the Ferrari team, so also a brilliant brain. And besides having a driver like Niki Lauda, having key people not only inside the car but also outside the car is really what you need to become successful. We saw this later when Ferrari became successful again in the beginning of the 2000s, it was not only Michael Schumacher, but also a lot of other key employees. So so you really have to understand the whole system, that you need smart people in the various positions and not just buy the best driver and hope that with this alone, this success will come back.
Mm-hmm.
Besides this, speaking about the design, I think also very 1970s design, the golden wheels, which we see here on the car.
Yes, absolutely. And quite, I mean, we talked about, you know, the disinterest Enzo Ferrari in aerodynamics, but I mean, you could see that here they were actually thinking about it. And
yes.
Yeah, trying to put some effort into it. Yeah, that's great.
That's right. And with this, we come to the BRM P201.
Yeah, that's what I mean. You know, look at this car. I mean, as much I absolutely love British cars, I have to say. And like I said, Lotus, one of my favorites. But when you look at the BRM, especially, like it doesn't quite matter which year you look at. It's a little bit like, you know, someone built it in a garage with parts that probably were not quite fitting together. I'm, you know, I don't want to offend any British engineers, but and like I said, I admire the innovative thinking. But yes, so you probably can see some really weird stuff on BRM that you will not see in other cars.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like you would have given the photos from all other cars of that year into an artificial intelligence that based on these photos to design a car and mix everything up, the result would be something like the BRM P201, which, I mean, you see parts which looks like that car, parts which looks like the other car.
It's just so random. It's beautiful. Yeah. Yeah, it's beautiful in its randomness. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, the shadow, the infamous shadow that basically, we suffered some big losses this season.
Yeah, I think interesting is that the color is somehow related to the name, as like a shadow, the car is practically completely black, only having prominently the US flag on the high intake.
And it's a little bit more straight and more square, as all American designs are.
Yes, that's right.
Surtees. Yeah, like a beautiful design, unfortunately not very practical, but in terms of just, you know, aesthetic kind of, if you look at it, the aesthetics of it, it looks really cute.
It looks cute, a little bit like a toy car, and so quite fitting Matchbox as their sponsor.
Yeah, I think that also reminds me, you know, this color scheme reminds me of the later Renault, when we had Fernando Alonso winning, really, really cute color combination.
Yep. And this we're coming to ISO. Mm-hmm. As we discussed in our episode about big tobacco in Formula One, Marlboro had a quite interesting strategy. So they had been main sponsor on one car, and in this season they've been main sponsor on two cars. And besides this, they've been like the third or fourth sponsor in a lot of cars. So they're not focused on one team, but practically quite brightly sponsoring the whole Formula One, practically all, most of the teams somewhere have had a Marlboro sponsor.
Yeah, and we can refer you to our special episode, well, two special episodes on big tobacco sponsorships.
Right. And with this, we're coming to another small team, the Japanese Marquee F101. Mm-hmm. Looks very beautiful, like right out of the movie 2001, with this white and yellow, very futuristic, very clean design, and practically no sponsors, which is from an aesthetical point, of course, quite nice. For the budget, less nice, of course. And also, unfortunately, the car not really played a role inside the championship, besides that it participated.
Yeah. Well, but that's typical for Japanese entrants. Yeah, because it's just the decision making in Formula One is very rapid, and of course, Japanese companies are not as rapid at making decisions. So.
Mostly not. I mean, I've no really insights into Marquee, who this was, as it's really quite small and fast
it's
and
a mysterious small
team.
Yeah, very small team. Mm-hmm. And Penske, so again, a very pretty car, very American. Again, we have some square on the edges. And a little bit more straight.
quite slim car, so quite similar to the design of the Shadow, and also similar to the Shadow, it has on the air intake the US flag. So quite similar related to design.
Absolutely.
And with this, becoming to a small but relatively successful team, the one man team, Heskes, where we had James Hunt as driver.
Yeah, and again, pretty car. A little bit reminds me about Surtees car, but yeah, cute, very cute.
Yep, very cute. I mean, also with the teddy bear and the British flag right in front. And but at the end, even if they've been successful, no sponsors. If we can believe the Rush movie, because Lord Heskes didn't want to have sponsors at the end, but then later also had a problem that no sponsors wanted to be on that car. Of course, not very sustainable.
Absolutely.
On the long run.
Absolutely. Yeah. We need to collaborate in Formula One to win. Yeah, and as usual, I think we discussed most of these drivers, and so now we turn to drivers, and so I think we've so the first three we've talked about all of them before. Yeah, just to basically note that Clary Gazzoni is probably the more experienced of the three. If we compare him with Emerson Fittipaldi, who's 28, and Jody Scheckter, who is 24. Yeah.
But we also have to say that I think Emerson Fittipaldi has more experience in Formula One, as he entered quite young, in opposite to Regazzoni, who entered quite late. And of course, Fittipaldi already had the experience of one title at that time.
Yeah, I also have to note that the typo on our slide, because obviously Fittipaldi is not with Lotus anymore, oh, yeah, he's with McLaren. Yeah, yeah, but nevertheless, I mean, he's the champion. So Niki Lauda in fourth place, yeah, Ronnie Peterson, Carlos Reutemann. Yeah, but a brilliant season. And yeah, just keep in mind that the difference between the places in this season was not huge. So it's really like basically many very, very competitive achievements from drivers and teams this season.
That's right. And the position 7-9 with Danny Halm for McLaren, James Hunt in the Heskers, and Patrick Depailler for Tyrrell. Oh. And is this becoming to behavior?
Yeah, so I think, yeah, again, we've discussed it at length. I don't know. So to me, apart from obviously Emerson Fittipaldi, I would like to highlight Niki Lauda. So for me, a very important season for him. Notable wins. Yeah, it's really hard to pick one. So do you have a favorite, Patrick?
No, honestly, no particular one.
So I will just say that this was a very cool competitive season with lots of surprises. So that's probably what I would like to highlight from the wins. So we had three very significant accidents four very significant accidents and two fatal accidents among them. So again, I don't want to pick one. All of them, I think, were pretty significant. And so again, in terms of the strategy, of course, it's this new analytics Ferrari. Ferrari McLaren rivalry that finally kind of started in this season, loud and proper. And of course, we can say that this was kind of the beginning of decline of Lotus from this point on. It was kind of downhill.
Yes, maybe later also could find a turnaround.
Yeah, so of course, but I mean, I think, it was still quite a...
Right, the next years they wouldn't be fighting directly at the top. Speaking about notable characters, I mean, this not aligned with one typical driver, but if you see the high chance of a fatal accident, which is practically not predictable or avoidable for you as a driver, as they had been triggered by technical failures of the car. I mean, you have to think about the general character of these people into stepping into these cars and drive them really at the limit. So I think in general, the character of the 1970 drivers, of course, has been completely different than today in the 2020s.
Yeah, definitely. All right. So legacy of the season. Yeah, to me, yeah, of course, so this is the McLaren season for me. So it's yeah. Probably the one of the rare seasons where you could all had you had really strong competition, and McLaren emerged at the top, which I think made a lot of good for this particular team and provided them with new opportunities.
Exactly, and besides this, of course, important for Emerson Fittipaldi, as he could prove that his first victory was not something due to luck or to
was not an accident.
It was not an accident, so he could repeat winning a championship, and this also with a different team. So this really underlines his skills.
Absolutely. Yeah, so with that, on that happy note, we again want to direct you to some special episodes that we have on the channel. And thank you again for watching. And we are on all social media, thanks to Patrick. So please check us out on other platforms. And of course, our main platform is YouTube. So we'll see you later.
Exactly. See you later.